example of these pastors, ministers, and reverends. We are here because one has gone to be with the Lord. Somebody ought to say amen. A preacher of the gospel, a singer, a prayer, a man who loved people, and people loved him. So at this time, we will have a musical selection by the Greater New Antioch Baptist Church and the Hopewell Baptist Church. Let's praise the Lord. Thank you.
our Old Testament scripture comes from the book of the 23rd Numbers of Psalms. Very, very familiar book. The Lord is my shepherd. I shall not want. He led me beside the still waters. He restores my soul. He led me in the paths of righteousness for his name's sake. Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for thou art with me. Thy rod and thy staff, they comfort me. Thou preparest a table before me in the presence of my enemies. Thou anointest my head full. My cup runneth over. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. The word of God for the people of God.
Giving honor to God, to this family, and to my friend's church family. First Thessalonians 4, beginning at verse 13. But I will not have you to be ignorant, brethren, concerning them which are asleep, that ye sorrow not, even as others which have no hope. For if we believe that Jesus died and rose again, even so them also which sleep in Jesus will God bring with him. For this we say unto you by the word of the Lord, that we which are alive and remain until the coming of the Lord shall not prevent them which are asleep. For the Lord himself shall descend from heaven with a shout, with the voice of the archangel, and with the trump of God. And the dead in Christ shall rise first. Then we which are alive and remain shall be caught up together with them in the clouds to meet the Lord in the air. And so shall we be ever with the Lord. Listen. Wherefore comfort one another with these words. The Lord bless the reading of his word.
May we pray. Almighty and everlasting, thou art God. We come today not in an ordinary way. And then God is not an ordinary person. We look to the hills from whence cometh our help. Our help come from thee, who made the heaven and the earth. God our Father, last week, my brother and I embraced one another, not knowing that he was going to answer the call so soon. He told me concerning a portion of his health, and I told him about mine. But both of us said to the other, we're going to make it. I see that he made it. before I did. But I'm here today to say that I'm still on my way. One of these mornings, it won't be long. You're going to look for me, and I'll be gone. Father, he left his mother, whom he cherishes every day. Oh, our Father, who art in the heaven, hallowed be thy name, thy kingdom come. Oh, if he had had his way, he would not have left mother here. He would have had an opportunity to wave goodbye. But Lord, we know you got all power. And then God, when it's all over, bless this family. Bless the word today. Bless the people who have come to say goodbye. And over yonder, when that day shall come, we will accept that what God has given us. This we ask in thy Son Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
And the church say amen. Amen. We'll say to mother that the other day, a word of comfort to her mother and to his brother, sister, to his nephew, nieces, family, and then to those churches that he pastored, to the friends and family, and to Hopewell, where he was one of the first ministers that I ordained after becoming the pastor of Hopewell Baptist Church 40 years ago. I want to say to Mother that he, the other day, Tuesday, he had an appointment. He thought earlier in the day that it was with the doctor. And he went to the doctor. But there was another appointment that was on the heavenly books. That appointment you can't erase. That appointment you can't miss. And I want to say to all of us, you too have an appointment that you can't cancel and you can't miss. So what happened? We could be selfish and keep him here, but you know he had a few physical problems. And now he doesn't have them anymore. Because his appointment was to go home. This is not home. So he went on furlough. He's at home now. And at home, there is no more sickness. No more doctor appointments. He's at home now. And in fact, he's at home waiting on us. And the scripture had just been read about comforting one another. That at one point, the trumpet shall sound. And those who are in the grave will get up. But be changed from mortal to immortality. those of us who are still alive, when Jesus come, he shall transform us, and we shall all be together. And he said, that is words that we should comfort each other, knowing that you believe that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of the living God. If you believe in your heart and confess with your mouth, thou shall be saved. If you want to see him again, make sure you confess hope in Christ. And then become a disciple of Jesus Christ. And you will see him again. Again. So what we are here to do is to celebrate. Now you do know how black folks celebrate. Yeah. Pastor Boatwright was a joker. He laughed. Yeah, he'll light up a room. So why are you so sad? Yeah, why are you so sad? This is celebration. Well, if you're a Christian, you ought to be used to this new wine. Look like y'all waiting on some old wine. But new wine comes from the inside. And you ought to celebrate his life, his death, and surely his resurrection. God bless you.
Let me make a quick announcement here. We are streaming this service, gnabc.org. If you want to text somebody, they can join us right now, gnabc.org. You can join us in right now. We're going to make a change. Virginia Smith, are you here? All right. She's going to sing now. And Pastor Tubbs is going to sing in just a few moments. Come right on, sweetheart.
Did the church say amen? Amen. The church say amen. Amen. Kenny was my backup. We was each other's backup. And I don't have my backup anymore. So he was a good plumber. He was a good cousin. He was a good brother. He was a good son. He was also a good man of God. I can depend on him when I'm out of town and I forget to look at my calendar and know that I have engagements, and I can always call Kenny and say, hey, cuz, I need you to fill in for me. I don't care where it's at. I got you, cuz, I got you. But you know, when I need you now, you got to be ready. You got to be ready when you deal with Kenny Boatwright at all time. He'll put you on the spot. But I just wanted to sing one of his songs, one of his favorite songs. I won't complain. I've had some good days. He had some hills to climb. Oh, Jesus. I've had some good days. I've had some hills to climb. I've had some weary days, and some sleepless nights, but when I look around and think things over, all of my good days outweigh my bad days. I won't complain. Sometimes his clouds would hang low. He can hardly see the road. He asks the question, Lord, why so much pain? But see, he knows what's best for us. Even though our weary eyes, they cannot see. So instead of complaining, can it just say, thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. I won't complain. I got to go to his voice because he said I used to get too high for him, and I'm going to try to do his. The Lord, he's been so good to me. That's what he'll say. He's been so good to me. More than this old world could ever be. He's been good. He's been good to me. He dried all of my tears away. And he turned many of Kenny midnights into day. So instead of complaining, he just said, thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. I won't complain. Oh, he dried all of my tears away. And he turned many of my midnights into day. So instead of complaining, I just say, thank you, Lord. When I've been misunderstood, thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. When I've been lied on, thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. I won't complain.
To this family, and truly you have our heartfelt sympathy. And I just want to share on behalf of the Greene County Missionary Baptist District Association, where I served as Pastor Boatwright's moderator. And joining us here today are some of our preachers and pastors from Greene County and some of the surrounding counties. If you all would please stand, all of our pastors from Greene County. Couple of other friends from Sumter and Hale County, Pastor Johnson and Pastor Williams, would you two please stand? And also we have with us some of our workers from the Greene County Association and representatives, our mayor from Utah, would you all please stand? Yeah. Amen. And I just wanted to say to you that Pastor Boatwright served well in Greene County. He was a great preacher, great man of God, great friend, and he will truly be missed. I remember when I was running for moderator, and he told me, he said, Royal, now I got to be honest with you because I don't sugarcoat nothing. I've already promised somebody my support, but if you win, you my moderator. And when I won, he walked up and shook my hand and said, bro, moderator. And he served faithfully. He loved our association. He loved Greene County. And he loved the St. Luke Missionary Baptist Church. St. Luke was his heart. And one of his members had started coming over to St. Paul, where I pastor on second and fourth Sundays, when they wouldn't have church. And I went to Pastor Boatwright's anniversary, and I said, I spoke to his member in front of him. I said, Doc, this is my new member right here. And he said, Royal, now you my friend, but you're going to make me cut you. Because I already ain't got but seven members down here. I ain't finna let you take all of them. And he would just always keep everybody's spirit lifted up. And we loved him in that area. He embraced me like a brother. And he would call me his little brother. And he served us well. On his birthday, he stopped by my house. And I told him, I said, Doc, I got something for you. And I was barbecuing. And I had some ribs and wings. And he wanted a steak, and I told him, I said, Doc, the steak ain't gonna be ready yet. He said, well, Roy, just fix me some ribs and some chicken, man. I got some folk waiting on me, and my family in town, they wanna celebrate me. I said, okay, and I fixed his plate and everything. And the next day, he called me. He said, Roy, I said, yes, sir. Man, I got something to tell you, Negro. I'm mad. I said, what's the matter, man? You didn't like your food? He said, yeah, I like the food. I ate one of the ribs, and I gave my mama one, and she enjoyed it. But I went to work, man, and my darn brother came by here and ate up all my ribs, man. And he said, I'm glad you didn't give me that steak, because I would have shot him by my steak. But he was just that person that would just keep you laughing, and you couldn't do anything but love him. He was a genuine brother. He loved the Lord. He loved his church. And he loved his pastor. Amen. He loved his pastor. And I told Pastor Jackson, you know, I knew an autobiography about you before I even met you. And I told him I actually thought he was older than what he was because the way Boatwright talked. And he said, no, man, we just been preaching a long time. He ain't that old. But he loved the Lord. He loved his church. And he loved to serve. And whenever he would put a post, when he had to preach somewhere, he would share a post, and he would always say, I'm getting ready to go do what I love. Pray for the preacher. And so we thank God for him. We thank God for his service, his dedication, his loyalty, his friendship. And we're saddened in this loss and heaven's gain. He will truly be missed, but we will continue to keep you in our prayers, and may the Lord continue to let his face shine upon you, and may he bless you is our prayer. Amen.
Would all of the ministers of the Birmingham Metropolitan Ministers Conference please stand? All of the ministers. Amen, amen, amen. Amen. Pastor Kenneth Boatwright was a member of the Birmingham Metropolitan Ministers Conference, where we meet every Tuesday here at the Greater New Antioch Missionary Baptist Church at 11 o'clock. And one thing I do know about it, he loved this minister conference. And he said his life has been blessed and his life has been changed because of his relationship he had with the minister conference. And I want to say there are many people who come and goes in and out of our lives, but there are those who come and they leave an indelible footprint upon our hearts. And Pastor Boatwright left an indelible footprint upon our hearts. And I want you to know we will never be the same since he's left. And we want the family to know that we loved Pastor Boatwright, and he loved us. We love family, friendship, and fun, and he was all of that. God bless you. God keep you. It's our prayer.
To Pastor Jackson, my friend and my brother and our president, will Representative Wanda Gavan, you can stand right, just stand right where you are. Representative Curtis Travis is still traveling this way, who represented Pastor Boatwright where he served as pastor. I represent Pastor Boatwright where he lived in District 57. I have a resolution that I'm not going to read, but I will say this. Boat taught us or reminded us of the sensitivity of life. From last Tuesday, he taught us that life is just like a whisper or a blink. But in the words of Boat, fellas, I see y'all after a while.
We are in receipt of the following resolutions. New Freedom Missionary Baptist Church, New Haven, Connecticut. Pastor Cecily Little is the pastor. Travelers Rest Missionary Baptist Church, Columbus, Ohio. Reverend Dr. Arthur Cumbis is the pastor. Unity Baptist Church, Columbus, Ohio. Vincent Golden is the pastor. And from the Greene County District Association. The Greater Ninayak Missionary Baptist Church Incorporated, 2900 Avenue G, Ensley, Birmingham, Alabama, 35218. Know all men by this presence that the Greater New Antioch Missionary Baptist Church Incorporated, pursuant to and by virtue of its authority, does hereby order, grant, ordain, and establish this resolution. Whereas the body of Greater New Antioch Missionary Baptist Church Incorporated is saddened to learn of the passing of one of its beloved members. But knowing that life is a precious jewel and is given to us to cherish and protect, we recognize that life is the gift of God and subject to his grace. And whereas Almighty God in his infinite wisdom called from our midst Pastor Kenneth Boatwright, who passed into eternity January 9th, 2024. And whereas Pastor Kenneth Boatwright is survived by his loving and devoted mother, 6 brothers, 1 sister, numerous nieces and nephews, and a host of family and friends, we know that his loved ones shall miss his presence, but know that his memory shall continue to be cherished and revered. And whereas Pastor Kenneth Boatwright was called to the ministry at the age of 16, he pastors churches in several states and was currently serving as the shepherd of St. Luke Missionary Baptist Church in Bologie, Alabama, and was a bright light for the Bologie Community Center. And whereas Pastor Kenneth Boatwright was a faithful, dedicated, and staunch supporter of the Greater New Antioch Missionary Baptist Church, which he loved dearly, he loved, honored, and respected his pastor. He provided comforting prayers, commitment, and uplifting praise to the service. And whereas Pastor Kenneth Boatwright was educated in the Jefferson County school system, further his education at the Birmingham Baptist Bible College, Esonia and Hoffer Seminaries. His mission was to do the work of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, sustain biblical doctrine, Christian growth, and evangelism to all people, preach and teach the gospel of Jesus Christ without compromise. And whereas Pastor Kenneth Boatwright, affectionately called Kenny by his family, loved and enjoyed spending time with his family and friends, often the life of the party, he kept those around him laughing and in stitches. Movies and television series was one of his favorite pastimes. He loved to preach and sing. Pastor Boatwright could bring down the walls once he started singing. And whereas Pastor Kenneth Boatwright was an entrepreneur and owner and operator of K&B Plumbing and Heating, other characteristics were jovial, laugh heartily, funny, loving, a man of faith, committed to the ministry, a heart for God's people, building and uplifting others. His memories shall forever be etched in the hearts of the greater New Antioch Missionary Baptist Church family. Now, therefore, be it resolved by the greater New Antioch Missionary Baptist Church Incorporated, with Pastor Edward O. Jackson Sr. concurring, we hereby send our sincerest condolences to the family and friends of Pastor Kenneth Boatwright upon his passing. May you seek comfort in the Word of God. Presented by the Greater New Antioch Missionary Baptist Church, the 19th day of January, 2024, Audrey A. White, Church Clerk, Dr. Igor Jackson, Senior Pastor.
A lot of you are texting people and telling them to go to Facebook. Let me say this again. We're not streaming on Facebook. GNABC. That's our church website. Click on live streaming and they'll be right in this service. Not on Facebook. GNABC.org.
The early years.
I met Pastor Boatwright as a teenager. He was a teenager. A member of the Pleasant Hill Baptist Church under the pastorate of Reverend Booker T. Benson. I was the moderator at the time of the Progressive District Association. Pleasant Hill was a part of that association, and Reverend Boatwright worked with the youth auxiliary. He was, to say he was energetic was an understatement. He was life. And in the early years, when he came to meet myself and Pastor Wilkes and Pastor January, when he came to Bessemer to 14th Street, well, even before then, when he was at Hopewell, we used to do this thing called Men of the Bible. And Boatwright had this great big old car. We used to call it the love boat. Because everybody on the program could get in the car. I'm talking about the soloist, the one who did the welcome and everybody. And and we were coming from Abernet, where Pastor Wilkes was pastoring, First Baptist Abernet. We had done a program down there, and Kenneth was driving, and we were all critiquing each other, and he wasn't saying anything, and I said, Kenneth, why are you not saying nothing? He said, because I know I flunked y'all. Didn't have to tell me. I know I have. But he was a brother. And I'm going to my seat on this, y'all. It don't seem right. Because he always called me big brother. Even the last time we talked Tuesday at lunch, he said, big bro, I want you to do my anniversary, first Sunday in September. I said, we'll be there, man. And it don't seem that big brother is supposed to be burying little brother.
How's everybody doing? Certainly we honor the presence of the Holy Spirit. To the eulogist and pastor of this great preacher who has been called home, Pastor Jackson. To his other pastor and dear friend, Pastor Rogers. To the worship leader for today's celebration. To all of the ministers of the gospel, brothers and sisters alike, to Mother Williams, the Boatwright family, which I feel like I'm a part of. I'd like to also recognize my newly beloved wife, Toy. To all of the ministers' wives and widows, greetings in the name of Jesus Christ. This has been tough from Tuesday before last, even to this present moment. Tuesday before last, Ms. Toy Brown and I was laughing and talking with my friend and my brother Boat in the evening. When he called me, he always tell me everything that had happened with him all day. This time he called me and he had been to the conference, and all of the things that happened at the conference he shared with me. We were just like that. We shared everything together. Even his next plans was that he and some of the guys from the conference would probably be going to the board meeting. I believe it was be held in Memphis. All of that he told me. I think he was trying to get me to say I'd meet him. He was my friend and my brother for a long time. My mentor and man that I looked up to that taught me mostly everything I know, Dr. Freddie L. Brown, passed and gone many years ago, introduced us. Must have been 1990. I met Boatwright at my church. Freddie was there doing a revival for me. I think that Freddie had already been in some parts of Connecticut where Boat and had already fellowshiped with him, and he drove on down from there to Mount Vernon where I was pastoring. We clicked at that service, and we've been friends and brothers ever since. Traveling different states, staying together at the hotels wherever the convention would be held, just to spend time together. I remember the last time that we spent, my daughter was having a first son, child. Boat and I was together. And he was praying with her and praying for me because we were away. But I can think of so many things, so many times and places that we were together and spent together. One thing I know, and that is that he loved God. He truly did love the Lord. He loved his family. He loved his mama. He always talked about Keith and Francis and everybody was so close to him. OJ and everybody was very close to Boat. As a matter of fact, I would say that he was the kind of guy that never met a stranger. For he had something funny and something kind to say to any and everybody. He walked a long time with the Lord, and the Lord walked with him. But we all know that when you're walking, you get a little tired after a while. He did his walking. He got to that point on this last Tuesday that, unbeknown to anyone else, I believe that he and God had already talked about it. For him to call me a couple of hours before he transitioned, I feel like he was trying to let me know that he had another place to go. He trying to make me think we were going to Memphis, Tennessee. And I was already getting set that I was going to tell him I'm not going. And I guess he know by now that journey where he did take. He left me behind. But one day, if the Lord continued to see things his way, which I know he will, we'll see him again. Now, I'm going to ask Reverend Holloway over there, there he is, on the console. He knows them old songs like Boatwright used to sing. And I'm going to ask that a bunch of his friends, them preachers that love to sing, and I know that every preacher in here loves to sing. And some of y'all, so y'all come on and join me. Come on, friend preachers that like to sing. I'm gonna hit something old that y'all know. And y'all can just jump in there behind me. have a few more. Tears to share. I have a few more. Troubles to bear. I have a few more. Times to give up. Right for the wrong. Oh yeah. I'll just keep on pressing on whether the battle is fought. Yeah. Victory have been won. But if you make it to glory, yeah, before I do, save a seat for me. Let me say it one more time. I have a few more tears to share. I have a few more burdens to bear. I have a few more times to give up, right for the wrong. Help me today, Lord, so I'll just keep on pressing onward. But oh, my battle is fought, yeah. I know the victory has been won, but if you make it to glory, before I do, save a seat for me. I need y'all to help me right here. Please, please, save a seat for a seat for me. I'm gonna be weary, and my soul need rest. Sometimes up, Lord, sometimes I'm down. I'm almost living to the ground, and I'm pressing. Keep on pressing forward. Sometimes my load too heavy to bear. But if you make it to glory, yeah, before I do, save a seat for me. Yeah, yeah. I'm telling you, I'm coming home. Won't take your rest, my friend. My time won't be long. One of these old days, and it won't be long. You look for me, and I'm going on home. And one day heaven gates will open. Oh, we'll be there, never to depart. If you make it to glory, oh, before I do, save a seat for me.
Thank you. Amen. 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 To the under shepherd of this house, Pastor Jackson. To the many pastors, ministers, and friends. We, the family, thank you for your generosity and your overabundance of love and support. He was a great pastor, teacher, and evangelist. Equally as important, he was our brother. With that thunderous voice he inherited from our father, he loved to sing, he loved to pray, and loved people. Kenny never met a stranger. Our dad would often say that Kenny would talk his way through life, and he did. He was that charismatic one. After a few minutes conversing with him, he had you. Often referring to his elderly members as Mama This or Mama That, he would capture them with his down-to-earth spirit, and the husbands would soon follow. Kenny loved God, and he knew unequivocally who God called him to do. He knew his purpose. Our brother left this world better than he found it. Our brother was the most giving and free-hearted person I've known. If he had it, you had it. And not just his family, but yours. I remember doing some of the early pastors' anniversaries. He would come home with bags of money or love offerings. He would scatter it onto the bed, and on multiple occasions, it would be more than $6,000 to $8,000. It looked as if he had robbed a bank. It would be in coins, dollar bills, and a mixture of different notes. He would take the entire family out for dinner to celebrate. God had blessed him, and he wanted to share those blessings with us. He would pay for the entire dinner bill, it seemed like, all in coins. The rest he would roll up into his pockets. We couldn't get the roll-up kind, not unless we wanted to hear the why, or what for, or when you're going to pay my money back. He always wanted to make our mom proud. Mom was his first lady always. Except that one time, he and Jerry had taken karate lessons, and Mama wanted to whoop him for something he had done. He called himself gonna do karate on her. And she said, "Boy, don't you do that stuff on me." Seriously, he would share with Mom as if it was hers. Whenever he fell down, she would be the first to tell him, "Get back up, dust yourself off, and keep on preaching and teaching, because man doesn't have a heaven or hell to put you in." Just as though she overlooked his faults, Kenny overlooked ours. That's what family does. He was a great storyteller, most preachers are. Kenny would begin telling a story while preaching to drive the scriptures home. He would say something like, Grandmama would say, and we would look at each other as brothers and say, Grandmama. After service, we would kid him and say, Grandmama. And he would say, well, I didn't say my grandmama. Because none of us knew our grandmother. Some of the older preachers, such as Reverend Bates and Reverend Craig of Hopewell, used to say that Kenny was an old man in a young man's body. And he laughed and preached and sang just like he was. Kenny loved to eat and could eat. I can remember in his early days of preaching when friends like the Reverend January, Kevin Bryant, Hammonds, and Palmore, just to name a few, would be around our dinner table, cutting up and enjoying the dinner. When they saw Mama, like Kenny, they would say, how you doing, Mama? And to this day, this still happens. Kenny had no problems inviting them over for some of Bep's good cooking. Then they would laugh emphatically and loudly at the dinner table. And like Kenny, all of them would later be called to pastor. Kenny would preach whenever and whenever God called. He would always be prepared and eager. He loved his colorful custom suits, gazelle glasses, dazzling jewelry, lizards, alligators, and ostrich shoes. Oh, and cologne. Boy, did he love his cologne. It was as if he's bathed in his cologne. Kenny didn't have any children, but he treated his nieces and nephews like they were his own. He gave most of them nicknames. Kenny lived life to the fullest. There was never a dull moment when he was around. I thank God for blessing us with him. You will always be our family's pastor. We are always proud to call you brother, no matter the conditions. And Mama was always proud to call you son. We love you and will miss you dearly. Things won't be the same. But we know heaven is rejoicing. And no doubt laughing. Because we all know you're up there telling them preacher jokes. And no doubt you are welcomed into your eternal heavenly home. Rest well, brother. Love you always. Your family.
And I can say,
that's it.
Never would have made it.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Ooh, never could have made it.
Hallelujah.
Without you, I would have lost it all.
Yeah.
But now I see how you're there for me. And I can say, I'm stronger. I'm wiser. I'm better.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
So much better.
Oh, hallelujah.
When I look back over all you brought me through, now I know
yes,
it was you I held on to. I'm strong. I'm wise.
Yes, sir.
Oh, I'm getting better.
Yes, sir.
So much better. I made it.
I'm wiser, I'm better, much better. When I look back over all your progress, I can see that you are the one I held on to, and I never,
never would have made it.
Oh, I never could have made it.
Pastor Kenneth Boatwright, the person, the friend. Might as well set the record straight. Mama, I couldn't do nothing with him. Couldn't do nothing with him. But everybody gave me the credit for trying to keep him straight. But I couldn't do nothing with him. He was loud. I discovered that when we were in the car together, both of us couldn't talk on the cell phone. Because he over-talked. But he loved family. He loved friends. He was a good brother, a good friend. He loved his church. I think one of the last conversations we had, we talked about 45 minutes about the vision that he had for his church and the sacrifices that he was going to make this year. But Kenneth Boatwright was some kind of preacher. He loved preachers, he loved preaching, he loved singing. And if you wanted to get him stirred up, all you had to do is talk about God's grace, talk about his forgiveness, and then talk about a God of another chance. And he'll bust out with that song he just played. never would have made it without you.
To God be the glory. This is a sad time for us in Greene County, but we know this is God's will, and his will must be done. Yeah. Pastor Boatwright was a dedicated leader and a faithful worker at the St. Luke Baptist Church. When he came down, he came in rolling up his sleeve because he saw that there was work to be done, both physically and spiritually. You know. And he loved it us, and we loved it him. He had got so comfortable with us down there that we'd be sitting down talking, and then he said, I just tell y'all all my business. But yeah, and he informed us. He said, God had given me a vision for St. Luke, and he was kind of blunt with it. He said, I'm your leader, and I'm not telling you all this to get your permission. He said, but I would love for you all to get on one accord so we can get the job done, you know. I was the Sunday school teacher, and he wanted to teach Bible class. But he said, Sis Jackie, I can't get everybody on one accord for me to do Bible class, but there's so much I need to tell you all about what God requires, you know. He said, so I'm going to have to take a few minutes of your Sunday school and teach Bible class, you know. I said, that's fine with me, Pastor, you know. So, yeah, he's truly going to be missed at St. Luke. We loved him, but he's gone, but he will never be forgotten. And I just like to say to the family, just continue in prayer and remain strong. You know, stay on the Lord's side, because with God on your side, you can't go wrong. We love you, Brother Jerry. God bless you.
Thank Lou Julian, Lord Pastor Boatwright. You know, y'all can sing, y'all can sing. When he first came, St. Luke, I got sick. He stepped in the own room. Deke. Yes, sir. You can't leave me, Deke. I said, Reb, I ain't going nowhere. You got to stay here, cause these folks down here, you know these folks. I don't. You got to help me with these folks. I said, yes, sir. Then he always called me on a Sunday morning. Deke, you up? I said, yes, sir, I'm up. Well, I'm finna get up and drink me some coffee and put my clothes on. I'll be on down. I said, okay. He always told me, he said, Deke, I said, yes, sir. He said, keep you 6 cold free. Why, real? He said, when you laid across there, them 6 got to take you out there. So I can see he got more than 6 cold free. And I'm going to truly miss him.
Good afternoon, everyone. First, I want to say thanks to all of the friends and relatives that came out for this homegoing celebration. We really appreciate it. I know I only have 2 minutes. I'm going to try to make this quick. I want to talk about the effect, because when we would have someone pass in the family, Boatwright, that's what I call them, would always be the first call. Cuz, you good? I'm like, I'm all right now, because he just had that, whatever that thing is, I can't explain it, and I'm sure some of you all feel that same thing from time to time with him. And one quick story. I was getting off work one evening, phone rang, I look, I'm like, Boatwright. He said, hey, cuz, I ran out of gas. I'm like, where you at? Because I'm in Atlanta, I'm thinking, you in Birmingham, why you calling me, telling me you ran out of gas? He said, man, I'm over here on I-20 by Panola Road. I said, okay. I'm like, Keith Lee, right up the street. I said, okay. So I get my little gas can, fill it up, go over there, give him the gas, and got done. He said, you got about $30. I'm like, wait a minute. I got to bring you guys to give you money. But I never said anything. So gave him the gas, gave him the money. And before I get to the truck, Boatwright, gone. I'm like, what? But the effect he had on me, I'm standing there, feel like I was obligated to do this. Because that's just the effect that he have on you. That it didn't matter how idiotic the situation seemed, you just felt like, for him, I got to do it. Thank you.
Come on, bless the Lord in here. Every hand ought to be together. Try that again. Bless the Lord in here. Dr. Boatwright, I've known since I was a boy preacher. And I started getting licensed when I was 8 years old, and Boat started when he was 16. Birmingham have had some great preachers. And Dr. Boat is a great orator, great preacher, great brother. Sister Boatwright, he loved his mother. Hang in there, baby. To the Boatwright family, hang in there. Thank you to this cadre of preachers who are here and to all of you friends and well-wishers. Boat, whenever he got a boat, had a little run, he just takes songs and run them together. We was here in this particular church in revival, citywide revival in May, and Dr. Jackson called Pastor Boatwright on the last night, the fourth night of the revival. And old Dr. Boat said, there are some things I may not know. There are some things that I can go. But this one thing, oh, I'm sure of, that God is real. Oh, I can feel him in my soul. Now you help me say that. Oh, yes, God is real. He's real. Yes, God is real. His love for me. Life is gold. Yes, God is real. And then Obo said, I've been through the storm and the rain. Oh, I made it. I've had heartaches and pains, but oh, I made it. Oh, sometimes I've been made to cry, and oh, I asked the Lord, I wonder why. But oh, hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Oh, I'm in. And then I heard it say, when I see Jesus, amen. When I see the one who died for me, the one who set me free, amen. All my troubles, all my trials, all my tribulations be over,
Oh, when I see Jesus. Amen. Well, Boatwright didn't sing this, but this call is tough today. There's a leak in this old building, and my soul, oh, my soul, oh, my soul, oh, there's a leak in this old building, and my soul, oh, a building not made by hand. Can I just say this here? I'm through. Amazing grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. Anybody here? I once was lost, but now I'm found. I was blind, but now I see. The building keep on leaning, but my soul, oh, my soul, oh, my soul, oh, the building keep on leaning, but my soul, oh, got a building not made. One more time in here. Oh, there's a leak in this old building, but my soul, oh, my soul, oh, my soul, yeah, there's a leak in this old building, but my soul, I got a building. Oh, this time, another year, oh, I may be dead and gone, but I'll let you know before I go, what will become of me. There's a leak in this old building, and my soul,
pastors, would you stand to receive the pastor of this church, our president, friend, and brother. Others could stand so that you can kind of let your blood circulate. Would you do that? Show some honor. Yes, that's good. That's good. That's good. You feel better. Let us receive Dr. E.O. Jackson, our president, our pastor, and a friend and a brother, the Dr. Kenneth Boatwright. Receive him now as he comes.
Our presider for today, Dr. E.E. Rogers, who has collaborated with me to make this service possible. And that's the way it ought to be. Sister churches ought to be able to work together. So I want to thank him for all that he has done to help with this day. And then to all of these pastors and preachers and ministers who come from everywhere, and particularly my brother, Dr. J.C. Wilkes, who's driven here from Gulfport, Mississippi. He's our friend. See Bishop Zachary Overton, who was driven over from Meridian, and other preachers, especially the Greene County crew. We thank God for them to look in their midst and see some of my students. Certainly delights being, and we thank God for all of them, and particularly these brothers who are part of the Birmingham Metropolitan Ministers Conference, who is our extended family. We spend so much time together. And then to Kenneth's family, and particularly his mother, she and I have gotten together and killed him any number of times. And every time we kill him, we resurrect him. And we thank God, and I want you to join me in celebrating her. She has loved Kenny, and it has proven it in so many ways. Then to his brothers, we thank God. They are my brothers. I've been with them so long. We thank God. And Keith and I probably tomorrow we'll be calling each other, and we're going to be asking, what you want? We've been talking and working all of this week to make this happen, and we thank God for all of them, especially my buddy Bruce. Amen. Love to hear Ken and Bruce get in a good argument. Wasn't they like it? It was an amazing thing. And then the only girl, Beverly, she and Kenny had some good ones too. I got a chance to hear some good ones, y'all. I used to say, I'm finna leave home. I'm finna go in and get on this. And so we thank God for them, and then all of his nieces and nephews. He did. He loved them tremendously. Tremendous. Not just OJ. You know, OJ was his child. Always told Ken, I said, now, Kenny, when you die, all your children gonna show up. So I'm looking around in here now. But we thank God for him. And thank God for the St. Luke Church, who he loved deeply and worked untiringly for them. And the great work, whenever I've gone down and to see the work he did to transform that building. So we thank God for them. Amen. And we thank God for pastors in Chicago. So many of them have texted us and called us and expressed their desire to be here, but due to the inclemency of the weather, they couldn't make it in. But we thank God. But I'm glad Joe made it, because, man, Boatwright loved you. Boatwright loved Joe, and we thank God. Now, y'all know I have 10 million Boatwright stories. 10 million Boatwright stories. We traveled together. We were, Joe, getting ready to go to Memphis. As a matter of fact, if I had not gotten a call or two, I probably would have been on the phone with him when this happened. We had just spoken with each other. We were trying to get ready for Memphis, and he had a problem. Reggie, Kenny had a problem. Kenny had and Reggie had secured our rooms. But Kenny didn't want Reggie to tell me that our rooms was in the casino. So Kenny said, Reggie, you better let me tell Pastor, cause he might go crazy, but I'ma calm him down. Kenny said, I'ma calm him down cause we need his American Express. Kenny said, Reggie, he got American Express gold and we need him. But let me tell him that our rooms are in the casino. And I want y'all to know I was going to go on and stay in the casino. And Kenny knew I was too stingy to gamble. And only thing I was praying that Freddie didn't show up. Because if Freddie came, Kenny wouldn't have heard a word of the convention. Because him and Freddie would have been in a come on, baby. So whenever Boat disappeared, he wouldn't answer his phone. I called Fred. I said, Freddie, tell Boat to stop gambling and answer the phone. And that was just Kenny. He was who he was. We were so different, but we have spent all of these years together. Wherever I would go to preach, Kenny was with me, and I was preaching and teaching Dr. Hammonds, and I'm going to preach in just a second, down in Conecuh County. And we were down, way down, in Nymphs, Alabama. On the other side of Burnt Corn, Alabama. And so I said I was doing some teaching, Dr. Bass, out of one of the books, and I said, I need to get y'all some copies of these books. And so family, a preacher down there, he said, Dr. Jackson, I will drive you to Montgomery to get the books. I said, all right, Reverend Johnson, let me see. But Kenny, Pastor, I'm not getting in that truck. I said, Kenny, why? He said, I'm going to give you two reasons. He said, you usually have 3 points, so I'm going to give you 2 points. He said, the first point is that man's truck is tow up. I said, all right, what's the second point? He said, the second point is that man ain't got no hands. So, he said, I'm gonna call Marilyn, Tip, and Jay and tell them what happened to you. And so we just thank God for him. He was with me when I met my wife. We were young preachers, and you know, when you get through preaching, you be looking. What y'all frowned up for? I wasn't married to nobody. And I said, Kenny, wait a minute, baby. He said, man, let's go. I said, hold up, Doc. He said, where you going? I said, man, I'm going to see who the yellow girl is. And I eased on over there. She couldn't stand me at first. But Kenny said, how'd you come out? I said, I got that number. So Kenny tells everybody, me, him, and Marilyn been married. Soon we'll be 41 years. And Kenny tried to make a little hit that night too, and he eased over to my wife's cousin, and And we tease Gerald about that now. He said, how are you? She said, And so that's just the way it has been. And Kenneth broke up with everybody right before Christmas, by the way. So I see y'all, but I ain't gonna point you out. It's bad when your pastor is your close friend. I'm not going to point out, but Kenneth broke up with everybody. And so we thank God for the long, long relationship that we have had. I looked over here and I see my friend who's resting in eternity, Pastor Alfonso January. I see his wife and his daughter. When Ken and I met at the Friendship Baptist Church there in Brighton. I was sitting next to January, did not know him. Wilkes was sitting on down the pew. R.L. Patterson with a humongous afro. We ran everywhere to hear him. So I was sitting next to January. Wilkes was on down the pew. Hammonds, he was sitting up front. He was our pastor. and was sitting there. Matter of fact, I was sitting next to January. And so Boatwright came in and said, hey, man, move down. Now, I'm from Cottageville. I'm from the north side of Birmingham. And Boatwright comes in and bumps me and said, move down. I look up like, who are you supposed to be? I think January saw I got a little teed off. January looked at me and said, who are you? I said, I'm Jackson. I'm from over in Birmingham. Man, I just came down here to church. And January said, all right, well, I'm January. February is on the way, but I'm marching on. And then Boatwright said, well, I'm Boat. I said, Boat? What kind of name is Boat? And later I found him to be Boatwright, and we made friends, and the rest is history. We've been together ever since, and we formed a brotherhood. We were different. There's nothing about us alike other than preaching. But we were inseparable. I didn't let him drive my car. Cause Kenny liked to look at you when he driving. I said, Boat, I can hear you, but look at the road, baby. He said, oh, Pat, I got this. I said, no, you once this car get pulled over, you won't get out of here. And we were just different, but we were inseparable. He made me mad a million times. And I tell him, don't call me no more. I want to talk to you. I don't want to be your friend. Till the next day, I called him, hey, man, what you doing? That's just how our relationship was. If Kenny didn't have any money and we went out to eat, he would order like he had money. Ken would have told everybody he was broke, but we would go to dinner. I'd just watch him. He just order, and I'd be watching him. I said, Kenny, I said, I'm going to tell you just like I tell my wife. I said, we go out to eat, and she just walk out the place. I said, one day, I'm going to swipe a card. They're going to say, decline. Kenny said, EO, when your car said decline, all of us in trouble. But he was my brother. He was my brother. He was my brother. And I'm terribly hurt. But this is God's business. Dr. Evie Hill, when he was funeralizing his wife, he said, the Lord gave. He said, but Christian maturity dictates that you read the rest of the verse. And the Lord takes away. Evie Hill said, if you're going to shout on he gave, I thought we'd get a little churchy in here. He said, you got to talk and shout on he takes away. So I shouted on the fact that God gave me this brother, this friend. But since God gave him, God reserved the right to take him. I want y'all to know, Kenneth left at home. He left at home and spent the day with us. And he ate. He had been a little sick the other week. And he ate. And all of these guys said, we eat together every Tuesday. And Kenny went back and got 3 chicken wings. And all of us said, Kenny, you eating like tomorrow ain't going to come. Well, I can't tell y'all where he told us to go. But we had a blast that day. As a matter of fact, I paid all of the members of our church and prayed for me. Ken is the 4th preacher that I would have lost out of this pulpit over the last few years. And when I paid everybody's dues, several guys jumped up in the conference, Little John and others, said, I'm joining Greater New Antioch. But Kenny Boatwright said, we ain't got no vacant chairs. He will never be forgotten. Family, and I'm not going to stop visiting and calling and Keith. This Bruce stopped by here so I can argue with you. I'm going to take Kenny place and bring Knock with you. You had to know the crew. So I want to talk for just a few moments. And I want to talk. If this was my day and Kenny was standing here, it would hurt him, but he would do it. Just a few months ago, when my sister next to me passed, and I said, I'm going to cut this out, preaching my family members' funerals. And I said to myself, who can I ask? I have so many friends. But I looked at Kenny, and he stood right here and preached to our family sitting right there. So there's a word very quickly, and I will not stand up here long, that I wanted to draw your attention to. It's in the book of Job. It's chapter number 19. And I want to read from verse 23 through verse 27. That's the book of Job. Chapter 19, verses 23, 24, 25, 26, and 27. I want these preachers to pray with me. These words are there out of the New American Standard translation of the Bible. Oh, that my words were written. Oh, that they were inscribed in a book. That with an iron syllabus and lead, they were engraved in the rock forever. As for me, I know that my Redeemer lives. And at the last day, he will take his stand on the earth. Even after my skin is destroyed, yet from my flesh I shall see God, whom I myself shall behold, and whom my eyes will see, and not another. My heart faints within me. This is the word of the Lord. And may the Lord use his words to speak to our hearts. I understand what it's like. I've done it quite a bit to preach in front of a lot of preachers. And we can always see something else. But I got the mic. Dr. Padmore, I want to tag this for Boatwright service, a preacher's last sermon. A preacher's last sermon. If I knew when I would preach my last one, I ponder, I wonder, what would I say? As should every preacher who preaches the gospel, we do understand that one day we're going to preach the last one. I don't know when. Talk to me, y'all. I don't know how long. But one of these days is going to be the last one. Now, someone said it. Every preacher, real preacher, God called preacher, at some point along the way has failed in his delivery of that sermon. We call it flunking. We do our best to put it together, but when we get up there, when we're at home, I wish I had somebody. When we're at home, we have it all together, but by the time we deliver it, it just does not come out right. And we leave knowing within ourselves that I failed. Are y'all hearing me here? But whether we are successful or failed, the last one is going to come. What would I talk about if I knew I was preaching my last one? That's what I want to talk about over my brother, because Job steps in and helps us out. Job does not style himself as a preacher. No. Job does not style himself as a prophet, but Job, Dr. Hammonds, recognizes that he is getting ready to say something that's great and profound. And since he recognizes that he's getting ready to say something great and profound, listen to what he says. Oh, that my words were written. Are y'all hearing me? Every preacher wants some of his sermons recorded. Y'all ain't talking to me. He wants to record. We want to leave something. The late Dr. Horace Pendleton Turner, who pastored the Canaan Baptist Church, preached in the pastor's conference one Tuesday, we shall never forget it. He said, brothers, you ought to leave something.
said, every Sunday when you get up to preach, anytime you get up to preach, Dr. Turner said, you ought to work on leaving something. I don't want anybody to remember the nice suits Boatwright wore. I don't want you just to remember the nice shoes he wore. I don't want you to remember how melodious his voice was and how much presence he had when he stood up here. No, 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 no. I want you to remember what he said. Job says, "Oh, that my words were written." He said, I wish somebody would put them in a book. Y'all ain't praying with me. He said, I want somebody to record so after I am gone, Job says, I want somebody to know that I passed by this way. Help me, Lord Jesus. Put him in a book. And since I know the story already from the beginning to the end, what Job said was recorded in the book. He says that with an iron syllables and lead, they would engrave them in the rock forever. Are y'all listening to me? Job said, I'm getting ready to drop a bomb. And Job says, I hope somebody writes down what I'm about to say. Job was in a horrific situation. Life had beat him up. Life had done him in. Job had experienced so much in life. I need to tell y'all, brothers and sisters, so many of us, we are guilty of looking at someone after they've come out of some situations. But what Job said, no, 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 don't look at me now. You should have seen me then. Are y'all hearing me? And every real preacher has a testimony. Talk to me, y'all. Kenneth Boatwright had a testimony. And Kenneth testifies to us that God has never called perfect people. Preachers, y'all ain't talking to me. He stands as a testimony that God, when he gets ready to call somebody, God looks on the trash pile of humanity. Where does he get preachers from? Brothers, we came from the trash pile. Don't sit in here and look all pious and act like you've never done anything. You've never said anything. Don't you look at Kenny any kind of way because I said Kenny would go by the casino. At least Kenny openly said he went. Some of y'all sneaking in there. All of us are flawed. But we've been called. Do I have any flawed folk in here? I said, all of us who preach the gospel, we are flawed, but God has called us because God can use no man greatly until he has first allowed them to be hurt severely so Kenny can really sing, I've been through the storm and the rain. But he said, I made it. Job said, I'm getting ready to give some preachers something that they could use for the last one. No need us getting scared. It's coming. The last one is coming. So when you preach, preach like it might be your last one. Y'all, come on, help me wrap this up. Preach like it might be. Job says, I want it written. And since it is written, here is a model, an example of what I believe Kenny would have preached if he knew it was his last one. Are y'all hearing me? And let me put this on the record in passing. Kenny wasn't scared to die.
We all laugh about it. Uh-huh. We all talk about it because we know it's coming.
Yeah. Yeah.
Talk to me, y'all.
Yes,
and Kenny knew one day it was going to come.
Yes,
but here's what a preacher would want you to know. Here's the first thing. If either one of these guys was up here preaching, or any preacher was up here preaching, and they knew it was that last one, they would be like Job. I wish it was written in a book. I wish it was written in stone. So that after I'm gone, somebody can recall what I said. But here at Greater New Antioch Church, I encourage the folk, fill your Bible with some of my alliterations. Put some of my points in your Bible. So that when I'm gone, you can open up your Bible and say that E.O. Jackson said. Are y'all hear me? Here's the first thing. The preacher's getting impatient. Here's the first thing. It's in verse 25. Here's the first thing a preacher would say if he knew it was his last sermon. The first thing he would say is this: my soul has been redeemed. Y'all ain't talking to me. It's right here in verse 25. He says in the New American Standard, as for me, I know. Help me, Lord Jesus. What do you know? Preacher, what do you know? He says, I know my Redeemer lives. Are y'all hearing me here? If there is any testimony a preacher ought to have, he ought to know that he has been redeemed. I'm not all I ought to be. Are y'all hearing me? I have some faults. Talk to me, somebody. I've had some slips and I've had some trips. That's what Boatwright would say. But Boatwright would say, in spite of all of that, one thing I know I am redeemed. Y'all listen. And Job says this, you know, the Bible is not chronologically arranged. It's logically. Y'all gonna leave? It's logically arranged. So Job is the oldest book in the Bible. So Job, Dr. Hammers, had nothing to draw from. He had no seminary, no scriptures, no sacred texts to look at to draw his conclusions. But Roya, some way, somehow, God, y'all not listening to me, God revealed to him, Job, there is a redeemer. Now, what is a redeemer? A redeemer is a person who steps in and buys a person out of debt. Brothers, those of us who preach, we're in debt. Y'all ain't talking to me. I said we're in debt and we need a redeemer. Are y'all listening to me? The world has got me in debt. But thank God, even though I am in debt, I have somebody that's going to show up on the scene and pay my debt. Are y'all listening to me? Now, the interesting thing for you theologians is this. Jesus had not yet been born. Y'all ain't talking to me. He had not yet been born. But Job
was able to look way down the road. Are y'all hearing me? And Joe was able, Dr. Perlmutter, to look way down the road, Dr. Rogers. And Dr. Wilkes, he was able to look down the road and see that scripture that said, before Abraham was. Before Abraham was, I am. My Redeemer lives. Nobody can come to me talking about no Boatwright faults. I am redeemed. I've been bought with a price. Huh? Job didn't know his name. I better go and do it before I explode. Job said, I know my Redeemer lives. Who is his Redeemer? Who redeemed Boatwright? Are y'all hearing me? Right around the corner. Pleasant Hill Church. Bates, Boatwright discovered that somebody, no, if you, I've never been there, thank God, but if you go to jail, somebody got to come and bail you out. I got to get through, I want my mother to sit through this. Sin put us in jail. Are y'all hearing me? And I bailed some folk out before. And you got to go to the bondsman office. Are y'all hearing me? But I need to tell y'all, when sin put us in jail, Jesus paid our bill. Are y'all hearing me? Brother, we got to let folk know that we've been redeemed. Don't preach how perfect you are. All of us are flawed. And y'all members, stop talking about them old preachers. All of us cut from, I wish I had somebody. All of us are cut from the same material. All of us have been saved by grace. That was both testimony. He didn't sweep nothing on the rug. Grace. So that's the first thing. That's the first thing that a preacher would want to preach if it's his last sermon. He would want the people to know that my soul has been redeemed. Here's the second thing. Stay right there. That's in verse 25. As for me, I know my Redeemer lives. And at the last day, he would take his stand. At the last, I need Dr. Alexander up here. You know, Dr. Alexander and Matt, some of these scholarly preachers. But this, at the last, what he's talking about is that Jesus is going to stand above all his enemies. All of those of you who putting him down, making fun of Jesus. At the last, he's going to stand above. And can I let y'all in on a little secret? And those who have died are going to come back with him. Jesus is going to stand head above his enemies. And Boatwright is going to be standing at his side. Here's the second thing. Not only, if I knew it was my last sermon, not only would I want you all to know that my soul has been redeemed. The next thing I want you to know is that, and that's what I've just talked about, that my Savior will return. Job stood on faith. He stood on faith. And there's no church, no seminary, no preachers, I've said. No scriptures.
Yet now there are 1,800 references to the Savior's return. Are y'all listening to me? Dr. Calvin got in an argument. And one preacher said that there is no way you can find anything in the Old Testament about the Savior's return. Preacher stood up and said, you can't get the Savior's return out of the Old Testament. But you got to watch old preachers. Young guy said you can't get him out of the Old Testament. But Dr. Hollingworth, that old preacher said, yeah, you can't get him out because he in there to stay. Are y'all listening to me? A preacher would want the people to know that my Savior, he shall return. And we need to preach that. We've got a little off track. The folk forced us off track. And we don't talk about his return anymore. They got us off track. They got us on money. They got us on crowds. Talk to me, y'all. They got us on prosperity. But the real message of the church in this day and time ought to be, and if it's going to be our last sermon, we ought to want to stand and tell the people the gospel story that on a Friday he died. I'm trying to get y'all to help me. And tell him he died, but that's not how the story is. 3 days later, he got up again. And he left. He left. As he was leaving, an angel started preaching. You men of Galilee, why do you stand here gazing up? Not some other one. This same Jesus that you see going away, he's coming back again. We need to turn, stand, and tell the church he's on his way back. My Savior. That's what Boat would do. Boat never got caught up in the new stuff. Most stay with what we started with. Are y'all hearing me? Yes. My Savior. Brother's going to be cold Sunday. Ain't the first time it's been cold. Huh? Come on in the church. Heat it up. And get up there and preach. And give them some good news. Got all kind of bad news. TL, they said some new virus out here. Are y'all hearing me? The CDC said we got to watch this. Measles are breaking out everywhere. Are y'all listening to me? But there's one thing that holds my mind together. I know my Redeemer lives, and that one day he will come again. I got to close now. I've been up here too long. So if it was your last sermon, first thing, Keith, you ought to want folk to know that my soul been redeemed. I ain't just up here playing preaching. Something happened. Huh? Anybody else in here, something happened? Y'all scared to talk about your call. Something happened. Are y'all hearing me? God picked us up. We didn't know John 3:16. And we preached a trial. Are y'all hearing me?
And the old man said, well, the little fella don't know nothing, but I think he got something I can work with. Are y'all hear me? Come in here, boy. Let me work with it. Get you a Titwell by book. Get you some Matthew Henrys. Get you a Star Manion. Sit yourself down and study the Word of God. Huh? Well, I'm going to preach. I'm going to preach this old stuff. The new stuff have made us so syrupy and sticky. I'm going to preach some of this old stuff. But here's the last thing. Family, we got to go. I didn't want to be here. I didn't want to come. I didn't go to the funeral home to look at Kenneth's body. I just couldn't. I didn't. But me and Kenny had a philosophy. The safest place for us is in the pulpit. Huh? I was going downhill, so I kept hearing scriptures. Dr. Rogers got up and talked. But here's the last thing. It's in verses 26 and 27. The last thing I would preach, Little John, if it was my last one, Bruce Johnson, Dr. Brown, the last thing I would preach is, not only has my soul been redeemed, my Savior will return, but it may be a little bad grammar, but in verses 26 and 27, I want to close on, I myself will be resurrected. Even after my skin, are y'all hearing me? Is destroyed. Yet the NASB says, from my flesh shall I see God? Bobby, Job is messing us up. Seems like to me Job is contradicting himself. Your skin is destroyed. The King James says, after the skin worms, destroy my body. But he says, but yet in my flesh, I need some church folk in here. Job seems like to me you're contradicting yourself. On one hand, you're saying you're going to be destroyed. But on the other hand, you're saying in the same body that's going to be destroyed, you shall see God. He gives us a few things here. He says, first of all, MacDade, Dr. Seller, Dr. Lewis, there has to be a departure. Flesh and blood. Can't inherit. Talk to me, preachers. If I had my way, family, Kenny would be where he normally is when a funeral is at this church that is right at my side. Because Kenny knew I can carry a tune, but I don't make it far. And Tuesday, in the meeting, Chris, family boat left me out there. I said, all right, brothers, Dr. Sellers is getting ready to preach. I said, let's do a little bit of this. I hit this little light of mine. I'm going to let it shine. I said, all right, Ken, I'm going to make one round. All downtown.
Kenneth looked up and smiled. He said, "Pastor, you on your own today." Are y'all hearing me here? And we didn't know that Kenneth was getting ready to make his departure. So I think I'll tell you, as I hasten to a close, you got to be ready every day, because you don't know the day, the hour, the minute, the second. You don't know when God will call your soul away. Help me, Lord Jesus. There was a departure. He left here. He got out of here. We didn't know it. We would have hugged him a little more if we had known he was finna get out of here. So brothers, on Tuesday when we gather, anytime you gather with friends or family, hug them a little more. There was a departure. He went home and he got out of here. Are y'all hearing me? I teased him when he ate those chicken wings. I said, "Kenny, you're eating like tomorrow is not going to come." But little did I know for him, tomorrow was not coming again on this side. Are y'all hearing me? But not only in the text is there a departure, there's also in the text a decomposition. He says, after my skin worms destroy this body. This body. Boy, I wish I could. That Kenny, he preached my first revival here. I'm coming up on my 41st year as pastor of this church. And Kenny came and did my revival. And Kenny had been to Chicago, Dr. Rogers, and he had nurses bringing him dry handkerchiefs. My member was like, "What he doing?" And one day that Kenny got that old thing. I'm wrapping up. He said, "Brothers and sisters, one day you're going to die. They're going to lay you down in a cold grave." This Kenny. "The worms going to come and eat up your flesh." Kenny said, "But that ain't all. The birds." I wish I had some country preachers in here. "Going to come and eat up the worm." That ain't all. "Then a hawk is gonna come and eat up the bird." Kenny said, "But that ain't all. Then an eagle is gonna come and eat up the hawk." Kenny could run that thing. Kenny said, "But when Jesus comes," Kenny said, "things are going to reverse themselves." He said, "The eagle," I'm trying to close here, y'all, "is going to give up the hawk." Are y'all hearing me here? When Jesus comes, that hawk is going to have to give up that bird. Talk to me, somebody. And then when Jesus comes, that bird is going to have to give up that worm. But Kenny said, "That ain't all." He said, "But the last thing that's going to happen, that worm is going to have to give up my flesh. There's going to be a decomposition, but that ain't the end of the story." Are y'all hearing me? We're going to take Kenny on to the cemetery. We're going to lay him down. Yes, we are. I'm broken, but we're going to lay him down. I'm hurt. A whole lot of us are hurt. We're going to miss him.
my life would never be the same. We talked every day. I'm going to tell y'all something. I got one last thing, and I'm going to throw it in here. Whoever heard, whenever I'm putting a sermon together, Kenny would tell me, Pastor, don't preach that no more. The other day, family, I was putting a sermon together. It's this sermon. Kenny said, let me hear the points. I said, Kenny, it's in there. I said, a soul has been redeemed. My Savior will return. And my soul is going to be resurrected. I myself will be resurrected. Kenny said, Pastor, don't come to Greene County with that. Are y'all hearing me? Whoever heard of a man hearing his eulogy? Y'all didn't hear me before he died. There is a departure. There's going to be a decomposition. I said, but Kenny, you know what I'm going to close on? He said, let me hear it. I said, in the text, there is a deliverer. Are y'all hearing me? Yet in my flesh shall I see God. Whom? I shall see for myself. And order for his body to come back together, he got to have a deliverer. His deliverer is Jesus. He will come back together. A little girl was with her mother. Great men deserve some more than a short eulogy. She's with her mother. And she and the mother took a nap. And the little girl woke up, but the mother didn't. She ran and got her father. She said, Daddy, Mama won't wake up. He said, oh, she'll get up in a minute. And the daddy ran in to the room. He said, wait a minute, something is wrong. And the father called 911. And they came. They worked on the mother, carried her to the hospital. Finally, the doctor came out, told the father, he said, she's gone. The father did his best, said, baby, come on in. I want to take you in here to see your mother. And the little girl went in the emergency room, and she said, Mama, wake up. Mama, wake up. That's how I was when I got down to that house. All the strength went out of my body. It's as if I wanted to say, Kenny, wake up. The doctor said, sir, do we need to call the chaplain? He said, yes, because I need some help with my daughter. And the chaplain came in. The little girl was saying, sir, tell my mama to wake up. The chaplain did his best. He said, do y'all have a pastor? They said, yes. They called the pastor. The pastor got there. The little girl looked at her pastor and said, Pastor, tell Mama to wake up. Pastor tried to work with her and talk to her. She said, but I've seen Mama do this before. She go to sleep every day. and she wake up. The father said, but baby, mama not going to wake up no more. She said, daddy, you playing. Mama do that. She go to sleep and wake up all day. The daddy said, but no, baby, mama ain't going to wake up. And you got to watch those old pastors. The daddy started trying to talk to the girl, and he said, baby, there's nobody in this world that can wake your mama up. Dr. Wilkes, the pastor, saw an opening. He slid right in. He said, remember, you are right. There's nobody in this world that can wake her up. But there's somebody in another world that's going to wake her up when he comes. Mother, Keith, Jerry, Bruce, all of y'all, Beverly, everybody. We can't wake Kenny up. There's nobody in this world that can wake him up. But there is somebody in another world. And when he comes, he's going to wake Kenny up.
Go to ask Brighton, Fiona Home, Kenny Scott. President, as you come, come on, give God some praise for that great sermon from our pastor and president. I saw some members from the greater 14th Street Baptist Church. Raise your hand if you're out there. If we go ask the Paul Barons to come. Flower Barons first. We're going to ask that no one stop the family. We're going to head to the cemetery. We need to get there before 3. Paul Barons, 2x2 at the side door. Paul Barons, you know who you are. Nephews. Let's go off to my right. Flower Barons, would you come and go out to my right? Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Flower Barons, thank you. Nephews, 2x2 to my right.